Hi there, this is the second and last part of the repair of the Global Specialties A201 Pulse and Function Generator plus Frequency Counter. I'm continuing where I left last time, so you may want to look at part 1 first. I'll leave a link in the description. At the end of the last video, I had traced the fault in the amplitude setting to a bad comparator LM311DP, and all LM311P I got from eBay failed in this test circuit. This is a new batch of mainly LM311N from a different vendor, and these work just fine. When simulating the 5V signal to engage the attenuator, the output goes high as it should. Although I ordered LM311N, the shipment contained one LM311P, which gave me an opportunity to test it as well. It works just fine. No difference between the N and P variants, at least for this circuit. This means the previous batch of 10 LM311P were really all junk. I'm not sending them back because they would just be resold to the next customer. I think I make a small video destroying them in various ways. Leave comments if you have particular ideas. I inserted one of the new LM311 into the socket 4U20, and finally, after weeks of fault finding, the amplitude now works as it should. At this stage, I should correct an error in the previous video spotted by Tony, where I said that the A201 amplitude setting shown on the display is the peak voltage. It is in fact the peak-to-peak voltage, but only if you have a 50 ohm load at the output. It only appears to be peak voltage, that is double as high, if, like now, a high impedance load of 1 meg ohm is connected, so that practically no current flows and there's only the tiniest voltage drop at the 50 ohm output impedance in the generator. Onwards and upwards then to the next problem I mentioned already. The message frequency error appears when selecting certain frequencies like 19.99 kHz, while 20 kHz is totally fine. And so is 20.1 kHz. This problem is likely in the part where the frequency is generated, which is not the easiest to understand. Very simplified, the A201 function pulse generator looks like this. There is a current generator which produces an up and down ramp of current to charge and discharge a selected capacitor. This basically produces the frequency in form of a triangular wave. The triangular wave is then converted to produce a sine wave. A level detector is used to produce a rectangular wave out of the triangular wave. This is the sync signal available at the front panel, but for the output, the rectangular wave is run through a pulse shaper to get steeper edges. There's another whole section of complex trigger and burst circuitry, which I will rather demonstrate than explain. So far, all this happens on the main board. The rectangular signal is also entered into the pulse generator. This is a separate board, and it basically uses the rectangular wave to generate pulses with variable pulse width, delay and duty cycle. Since my generator has the optional rise and fall board, the pulse rise and fall edges can be given variable slopes. In all variants of the A201, this board contains at least a frequency counter with its own time base. So by now, 4 signals have been produced, namely a sine, triangular, rectangular and pulse signal. The final amplifier board contains a selector that picks one of these, amplifies it, and provides selectable attenuation and offset, and the final attenuation after the power amp. I think from the first video you're now quite familiar with this part. Here's a slightly more detailed view of the current generator and VCO. It is quite interesting that the generator doesn't produce the frequency digitally. Instead, it basically uses a digital to analog converter to generate a voltage that, converted to currents and together with the selected capacitor, determines the frequency of the triangular wave. This is a real VCO, or voltage controlled oscillator, and it can therefore be just as well controlled by an externally provided voltage. You may wonder, how does the CPU know which digital word to use to produce a voltage that generates the desired frequency? The manual doesn't explain this at all, but I think the frequency error problem provides a clue. I think the CPU simply uses the built-in frequency counter to check if the commanded current with the selected range capacitor produces a frequency that is within the tolerance spec. This concept also means that frequencies are not as exact or stable as you might expect from modern generators, where all frequencies are generated digital from a master clock. There is no master clock in the 8201, which is using a free-running VCO, and for the same reason, you can only select frequencies through the four most significant digits. Back to my problem. The CPU is happy with the generated 20 kHz, but as soon as I select 19.99, it finds that the generated frequency is too far off from the target and displays frequency error to alert to this fact. The fault is therefore either in the DAC or digital to analog converter of the current generator, which seems to work fine for some but not for other frequencies, or in the capacitor selection, picking the wrong or a duff capacitor. I decided to investigate the digital to analog converter first. As you would expect for a system with, for the 1980s, a relatively wide frequency range, we have actually three DAC chips that control the current generator. You will recognize a familiar pattern from the first video. 4094 shift registers converting a serial data stream into parallel data on their outputs when the strobe signal is activated, and these outputs provide then the digital data word to be converted into analog signals. Without going into details, I used the same method as for the offset error in part 1 by changing frequencies and looking for a change in the analog outputs. Sure enough, I found that the signal at pin 1 of U36 did not change at all, whatever was selected. I replaced it with a new AD7533, which you see here. This is the second of these chips that has gone bad. One wonders if there's a common cause, considering that this generator contains a lot more of these. Let's leave that for the future. As you can see, the new chip fixed the frequency error and frequency selection works fine now. But maybe you noticed the increasing background noise over the last couple of scenes. That grinding noise is the 8201's fan's way of announcing its imminent failure. This is how it sounded shortly after the frequency error fix. It's not just the noise, its performance was getting weaker by the minute, with the danger of overheating the unit. I had to take the rear panel apart to be able to reach the bottom screws holding the fan. The problem is that this Sunon fan is a 115V AC type, and new 115V types of this size are very expensive to get in a 230V country like the UK. I'm looking for a new because replacing a used fan with a used fan makes little sense. The fan is quite ingeniously wired with a transformer and the mains voltage selector to work at 115V regardless what mains voltage is selected. It would be a shame to replace that with a hardwired 230V type, so I decided to repair it for now and worry about replacement later once I know that the generator is actually fully working again. Removing the label reveals a plug that gives access to the bearing, and I added a drop of oil for lubrication. Judging from the fact that the label was half off already, this procedure has been done at least once before. It is of course a temporary fix only. And wow, what a difference a drop of oil makes. The fan is so silent that it's hard to know if it's actually running. It spins also much faster, which is certainly a good thing. Well, it seems that all obvious defects are fixed now, and so it's time to follow the recommendation in the manual to run the performance check procedures after repair. It is quite comprehensive, as you can see from the topics, and after spending so much time on the repair, I'm a bit concerned that the test will find some serious flaw I can't fix economically, and all the previous work was in vain. The procedures also require a lot of high-end test gear I don't have, so some improvisation will be needed. Anyway, let's find out what my generator can still do versus what it should be able to do and get started. Which is verifying frequency at an amplitude of 1.5 volts against the 50 ohm terminator with 0.999 Hz as the first value called out by the procedure. For all frequency tests, I use my recently repaired HP5334B counter with an external GPSDO or GPS disciplined oscillator as a time base. Well, 0.943 Hz seems a bit too low. The next value is 1.999 Hz, and for this and subsequent similar values, I found it way easier to enter 2 and then use the up-down buttons to decrement by 1. 1.999 something, that looks a lot better. 19.99 Hz next, using the same method, but in the interest of speed, I show only the final step from now on. 19.99 Hz looks alright. 199.9 Hz is okay too. 1.999 kHz. 1.998 kHz is within the specified tolerance of plus minus 1 Hz. 19.99 kHz looks alright. 199.9 kHz. Again, 199.8 kHz is within the specified tolerance of plus minus 100 Hz. 1.999 MHz. 1.998 MHz is within the required plus minus 1 kHz. 19.99 MHz is fine. Before proceeding, it turns out I have a terminator problem. And no, I don't mean a T-800, also known as Arnie Schwarzenegger.
I'll be back.
For the preceding frequency test, the call for amplitude was just 1.5 volt peak to peak, and so I just selected the 50 ohm input option of my frequency counter. But the amplitude tests, as well as some other measurements using scopes and frequency counters, are supposed to use much higher outputs with a 50 ohm termination to match the internal impedance of the generator. Before embarking on these tests, it's worth considering this for a moment. Your test equipment will thank you for it. The highest voltage the 8201 produces and which I have to test is 15 volts peak to peak onto a 50 ohm load. I show here what equivalent RMS voltages we can expect for the three different waveforms that need to be verified. If you are interested in what that means and why they are different for different waveforms, I have made a couple of videos where I explain this, links in the card or in the description below. Once we know the RMS voltage, we can calculate the power dissipated in the load resistor and in the A201 amplifier for that matter. The worst case is the rectangular wave with more than 1.1 watts, but even the others are way beyond standard quarter watt rated resistors. This is way more than most devices with built-in 50 ohm inputs can handle. For example, my 5334B counter calls anything above 5 volts into 50 ohms the equipment danger zone. 5 volts at 50 ohms means the internal terminator is rated at 0.5 watts. And that is also true for my external 50 ohm terminators for use with equipments that only have high impedance inputs. If you have equipment that offers 50 ohm termination, you should check what the maximum allowed voltage is. 5 volt doesn't sound like a dangerous voltage limit, but in this case it is, and it already exceeded by 2 of the 3 waveforms. Now, higher rated terminators are available, but good ones are not cheap. Making a good one yourself is not easy either because of the tricky behavior at high frequencies. In the end, I decided to make one that can handle the 15 volts peak to peak, is mainly for low frequencies, but maybe still usable at higher frequencies. To make it, I need to order some 1% 2 watts 100 ohm metal film resistors, which I did not have. While waiting for them to arrive, and since the amplitude test uses just 1 kHz and for a quick check only, I rigged my 100 watt power resistor set to as close as possible 50 ohm, should be good enough for this test, just to see if the amplitudes are in the right ballpark. 15 volts peak to peak and rectangular waveform should produce 7.5 volts RMS, so 7.83 volts is definitely too high. The triangular waveform should be 4.3 volts, but I'm only getting 4.03, so that's too low. And for sinusoidal waves, I only get 5.1 volts instead of 5.3, also too low. There's no point continuing with more amplitude tests until the values are adjusted. Let's look at offset instead. This generator with all buttons the same color and in no logical order is a usability nightmare. One day, I swear, I put different colored dots on num, exp and ent. Anyway, I finally have a plus 5 volt offset. I have to deviate from the manual because the BM869S in AC mode does not care about DC offsets. I could use AC plus DC mode, but I'm not sure if the meter in the procedure was doing that either. So I decided to simply use the BM869S showing AC and DC components separately, which you see now. It looks as if at 5.06 volts the offset is a little too high. Anyway, there's no point continuing testing other offset values until that is fixed. Next, I had to verify the characteristics of the rectangular wave, namely the rise and fall times and the overshoot at 10 MHz and 15 volts peak to peak into 50 ohms, but at that frequency my self-made terminator produced too much ringing, so I had to use a lower voltage and a standard terminator. For reference, I made this sketch to explain some of the terms. The rise and fall times are normally measured using a scope, but some frequency counters like my HP5334B can figure out the 10% and 90% and do it for you. By the spec, rise and fall times should be less than 12 nanoseconds. And rise time is about 10 nanoseconds and fall time about 8 or 9, so that looks good, but I will have to repeat this at 15 volts peak to peak when I get a better terminator. On the scope, the picture looks like this. According to the spec, the overshoot should be less than 5%, which it is, but only if a proper terminator is used. I may run this test again when I get better terminators, but for now I consider the square waveform to be okay. Not having anything better to measure sine distortion, eyeballing the good old Rigol FFT of my scope will have to do. This is the spectrum of the sine wave at 10 Hz, reasonably free of additional peaks and harmonics. As a proof of the pudding, the triangular wave and its harmonics, and the rectangular wave with lots of harmonics. Back to sine and its relative smoothness. This is the same test at 1 kHz. First the sine, now the triangular wave, and the rectangular wave, and back to sine. And one more time, but now for 1 MHz. Sine, triangular, rectangular, and back to sine. In the absence of anything better to measure it, I'm happy with the sine waveform. Next, I'm supposed to verify the flatness of the sine output. That is, the output voltage should not change significantly over the frequency range. The procedure asks for this to be tested using the scope. One is supposed to make the wave image on the scope at 1.99 kHz exactly 6 vertical divisions high, which I have marked with the cursors. Then change frequency to 1.99 MHz and check that it doesn't change by more than 5%, like a drop below 5.7 divisions. It is still close to the 6 vertical divisions and the volts peak-to-peak readout confirms the visual, which is a change of around 1.3%, so well within specs. Next, the procedure asks for 20 MHz and the signal should not have changed by more than 15%, like a drop to 5.1 divisions. A quick adjustment of the scope time base and the voltage peak to peak has dropped from 15.2 to 14.5 volts peak to peak, which is about 4.6%. Visually, it still occupies about 5.8 divisions, so again we are well within specs for flatness, but of course all this depends how flat the scope's frequency response itself is. The first test of rectangular symmetry is 50% duty cycle at 19.99 kHz, so something my Brymon 869S can handle. The duty cycle should be within 0.2% or 50%, which it is. I then select 70%, and that should produce a rectangular wave with a duty cycle between plus minus 2% of 70%, and as you can see, it certainly is. One more test selecting 15% duty cycle, and again the output is well within the plus minus 2% spec. For the same test at 1.99 MHz, I have to use the scope. The duty cycle is just within the 0.2% of the 50%. Selecting 20% on the A201 and the result at 18.8% is just within the plus minus 2% spec. Dropping down to 10% and with 9.8 it remains just within spec. Selecting 80% and with 79.6, it's well within spec. And with 90.22 for 90%, it remains very close. So all in all, I think symmetry is good enough. To demonstrate the complex gated, triggered and burst functions, I set the 8201 to produce a 20 kHz sine wave and my other function generator to produce a 1 kHz rectangular wave into the trigger input. You can see both the 8201's output and the trigger input on the scope meter, which is set to trigger on the external 1 kHz signal. Therefore, the 20 kHz signal is just a blur. If I enable gated, the output will only be enabled as long as the trigger signal is high. So in this case, for 500 microseconds, which is enough to let 10 periods of the 20 kHz signal slip through the gate. The trigger mode works differently. In this case, I select rising edge, so when that is detected, exactly one period of the output wave is enabled. And burst mode, together with a trigger signal, allows you to let more than one period of the generated frequency out. The minimum burst is 2. But we can, of course, select more. In fact, you can select quite a lot more. Here, as part of the performance test, the generator is running at 199 kHz. The burst count is set to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and the waveform is rectangular. I set my other function generator providing the external trigger signal to 0.1 Hz, that is a trigger every 10 seconds. This gives me enough time to manually reset the totalizer on my frequency counter. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 as specified, so the burst mode works fine. Next, I have to verify that the specified pulse width is within spec. This requires rather tediously entering of pulse width and pulse period pairs for each step, so I just show the results as measured by my frequency counter. For each of these pairs, the procedure specifies a tolerance which the measurement value must not exceed. 25 milliseconds plus minus 1.25 milliseconds, 2.6 milliseconds plus minus 0.13 milliseconds, 1 milliseconds plus minus 0.05 milliseconds, 100 microseconds plus minus 5 microseconds, 10 microseconds plus minus 0.5 microseconds, 1 microsecond plus minus 0.055 microseconds, 100 nanoseconds plus minus 10 nanoseconds, 25 nanoseconds plus minus 6 nanoseconds, and we are still just 1 or 2 nanoseconds off. Overall, I think pulse width is absolutely fine. Next is pulse delay, and I start with the fastest time to verify, which I'm supposed to do on the scope. I show this first because it makes it clear what this is all about and possible pitfalls with this measurement. The blue trace shows the sync signal, while the yellow trace shows the output pulse with the 100 nanoseconds pulse width. The scope reveals that relative to the sync pulse, the output pulse is already delayed by slightly less than 100 nanoseconds, even though the delay is not active at the moment. This minimum delay is basically the travel time of the output signal through the pulse generator and shaper, rise, fall and final amplifier boards, because the sync signal skips all these. If I enable the 200 nanoseconds delay, the output gets delayed by another 204 nanoseconds according to the cursor measurements. The tolerance is plus minus 15 nanoseconds, so the delay is fine. Of course, if you measure the delay from the rising edge of the sync signal to the start of the pulse, like a frequency counter would, it will be almost 300 nanoseconds, which is why you can't use the frequency counter to verify small delay settings of this generator. By the way, the generator allows you to use the delay function for another purpose. In double pulse mode, it defines the time between the two pulses. But the counter is perfectly fine as long as the error due to the unavoidable delay is small compared to the desired delay setting. The sync signal goes into input A of the counter and the output into input B. The counter is set to measure the time from a rising edge on A to one on B. Both test leads have to be the same length, because 1 meter RG45 coax cable adds about 5 nanoseconds delay. all tests use the same 100 nanosecond pulse width but need tedious settings of delay and period value pairs for each test, which I skip showing. We start with a delay of 25 milliseconds with an allowed tolerance of plus minus 1.25 milliseconds, 2.6 milliseconds next with a tolerance of 0.13 milliseconds, 2 milliseconds with a tolerance of 0.1 milliseconds, 200 microseconds with a tolerance of 10 microseconds, 20 microseconds with a tolerance of 1 microsecond, 2 microseconds with a tolerance of 0.1 microseconds, and we are still in spec with 0.08 microseconds off, and we know that these 80 nanoseconds are basically the unavoidable sync delay I showed earlier. In total, pulse delay works within the allowed tolerances. Pulse lead and trail times next. The terms refers to the steepness of the leading and trailing slopes of the pulses. Normally you like them as steep as possible, but you may want to test the behavior of some devices when the pulse edges it receives are no longer steep. The test follows the same pattern as before, except for this one, one has to enter three parameters for each test: the period, the pulse width, and the leading trail time. I decided to show the results both on my scope and the HP5334B. We start with entering 1 milliseconds lead and trail time with a tolerance of plus minus 50 microseconds. Trail just a tad outside with 55 microseconds. 10 microseconds lead and trail with plus minus 5 microseconds. Now 1 microseconds lead and trail plus minus 50 nanoseconds tolerance. The last setting is 100 nanoseconds lead and trail with plus minus 5 nanoseconds. All the while the procedure was using the same values for lead and trail, but they don't have to be the same. On this generator, they are not totally independent from each other, but it's completely possible to just have a far greater lead time than trail, as you can see, and of course, you can do the same for trail. Overall, with one slight excursion, the lead trail time is okay, and I decided to leave it alone. As you know by now, the internal oscillator in the generator is actually a VCO, or voltage controlled oscillator. There's an external input that allows applying a voltage to change the frequency. The test procedure calls for a voltage of nearly 10 volts DC, so I decided to use my recently restored vintage analog meter to show the DC part. It is set to 10 volts full scale. As you can see, the frequency drops as the voltage rises. The change is quite significant, dropping from about 2 MHz at 0 volts to just 100 kHz or so at 8 volts. The test procedure also calls to use an external sine wave to be applied to the VCO input to perform a frequency modulation. This works, of course, but it's hard to show visually. In the end, I reduce the external sine wave frequency to 1 Hz or so, which creates this accordion interference pattern. It's less obvious on camera than on the scope screen, but I hope you can make it out. Another input allows the direct influence on the analog voltage determining the pulse width, which is why this input is called PWM, or pulse width modulation. I used a very slow external sine wave, shown in blue on the scope, connected to the PWM input while the pulses are in yellow. At the end of the performance test, this is the scorecard. Frequency is generally okay, except for below 1 Hz, which needs to be adjusted. Amplitude for all three waveforms is out of spec and has to be adjusted, and I might want to try to adjust the offset slightly. On the lead trail test, there was one value where the trail was slightly above the tolerance, but that's not something easy to fix, so I decided to live with that. Everything else is still within tolerance after so many years and serious faults, an amazing result. Before I move on to the necessary adjustment, a quick sidetrack. It turns out that GPIB remote interface is working as well. For example, setting the amplitude to 1.3 volts peak to peak, changing the display to show frequency, which happens to be 1 kHz, changing frequency to 123.4 kHz. This is a huge time saver when running tests, considering the clunky front panel interface. So on with the adjustments of the low frequencies first. Its adjustment trim pot is down in the main board, and sorry, I did not realize that the camera accidentally focused on the rise fall board. Anyway, there isn't much to see because the trim pot is very sensitive, so the tweaks are really, really tiny. The low frequency accuracy is supposed to be calibrated at 9.9 Hz. It's 9.78 Hz at the moment, and because adjusting takes time, I speed up the video a bit. In the end, I decided to leave it at 9.89, which seems close enough for 9.9. The working GPIB interface allows me to run a script that simply moves the 8201 slowly through the very low frequency range and records the results on the HP5334B, which is of course also under GPIB remote control to collect the results. Because of the low frequencies, one has to wait for at least one period to measure the result, and for the lowest possible value of 0.002 Hz, that is 500 seconds or more than 8 minutes. I don't have that much time and probably will never use these low frequencies on the 8201 anyway. So I started with 0.01 Hz, which still needs 100 seconds. But the waiting gets shorter the higher the frequencies. This is the result. Obviously, the low frequencies are not terribly accurate, but then the tolerance in that range is plus minus 3% and it's definitely in there. Notice the first try heading? More about that in a moment. I used the same method to test the A201's frequency accuracy from 10 Hz to 20 MHz in 321 steps. And that isn't too impressive either, but given the age of the unit, I did actually expect a worse picture. Except for two peaks of 1.2% at very low and very high frequencies, the accuracy is better than 1% overall and 0.2% in the important range from 200 Hz to 2 MHz. You can actually see from the curve where the generator switches capacitors in and out in the VCO. Here at 20 Hz, 200 Hz, 2 kHz, 20 kHz, 200 kHz and 2 meg. It needs to be said that according to the spec, the frequency error should only be 0.1%, but to adjust frequency to that level, the instructions say that you need to solder correction capacitors in on a trial and error basis, and that's where I draw the line in the effort I want to spend on this. I have other ways of generating more exact frequencies at a higher resolution if I need them, so this is how it will stay, or so I thought. Then I used my frequency counter to check frequency drift and jitter during startup as the device warms up and after it stabilizes. I put a temperature sensor inside the unit and another outside to measure room temperature and simply recorded frequency sample after sample without changing anything. The temperature inside the A201 is the blue trace and the room temperature is the red trace. The yellow trace is the error in percent against the selected 1 kHz. First of all, I'm quite pleased by the low drift and jitter over 2 hours, which is better than the 0.1 spec. And secondly, I'm relieved to see that the temperature inside stays quite reasonable despite the heat generated by all the electronics. The repair of the fan was obviously effective, at least for now. The startup is quite interesting, and I added an enlarged portion of the graph. There's this big zigzag in the yellow trace. It almost looks as if the processor, using the built-in frequency counter, noticed that the frequency error was getting too high, 0.04% in this case, and it applied some correction to the VCO. That would be very nice of the processor, but the flaw with that theory is that it opens the question, why did it not intervene when we saw frequency errors that were as high as 1.2% earlier? To see if that was a one-off incident, I repeated the test first thing in the morning with the unit off overnight, so the start temperature is much lower and it shows the same behavior, not just once but twice. Very early in the test, the frequency reached the magic plus 0.04% error, then something happened and the error started to fall slowly until it reaches minus 0.04 when another correction was applied and the frequency stabilized for the rest of the test. So, if the processor is really keeping an eye on the frequency error, why did I see such high errors earlier? One possibility is that I simply measured too soon, right after commanding the new frequency, before the processor had time to check it and apply any corrections. To test that, I modified my scripts to give the processor a few seconds time before measuring the frequency. And what a difference that made! On the top you see the new error graph in red overlaid on the previous first try measurements. The bottom graph is just the new measurements on a large scale. Except for a few minor peaks, the frequency accuracy now meets the 0.1% criteria, and those peaks stay well below 0.2%. I wonder if the frequency accuracy gets even better if I keep the same frequency for longer, maybe down to 0.04%? But that test would be extremely time consuming, so I'm not going to try that for now. And the low frequencies? I tried the same trick, and from 1 Hz onwards, the frequencies are obviously corrected, and now in the 0.1% tolerance spec except for a small peak at 3 Hz. For the frequencies below 1 Hz, the spec is 3%, and obviously that jump in tolerance is needed because the correction is no longer applied. Enough of that. After all that exhaustive look at frequencies, it's high time to calibrate the amplitude and offset and call it done. Calibration of the amplitude has to be done at 1 kHz and 15 volts peak to peak against the 50 ohm load. It has to be done for all three waveforms. I did the calibration over 2 different days. Here's the one for the rectangle, and the target is 7.5 volts. Because it's a long process, the videos are sped up considerably. Rectangle has 2 trim pots, one for the amplitude of the positive part and one for the amplitude of the negative part, so one has to adjust both not only so that the overall voltage is 7.5 volts, but also that the positive and negative parts are as equal as possible. For the latter part, I decided to switch temporarily to DC mode on the Brymen, because if the positive and negative parts are exactly equal, they cancel each other. Now for the sine waveform. The target for that is 5.3 volts and it's just 1 trim pot to adjust, but rather sensitive. Moving on to triangle, and the target is 4.33 volts. It is again tricky because only the tiniest movements have already quite a change. For good measure, I decided to check if the rectangle is still 7.5 volts a couple of days after the adjustment, and the voltage sort of creeps there. I have the sneaky suspicion that this is my 50 ohm load heating up. I should probably recalibrate this with a better load that is less likely to get hot and drift in its resistance value. Finally, a view of my makeshift 50 ohm terminator. It consists of 2 100 ohm 2 watt 1% resistors in parallel. This means they form a 50 ohm 4 watt load, and although the power during this adjustment is only 1.2 watts, they do get hot, especially in the rectangle mode. It is difficult to get proper thermal contact, and it feels quite a bit hotter than the shown 55 degrees Celsius. Anyway, I decided to run a test ramping up the amplitude from 1 millivolt to 15 volts in about 170 steps and measure the result. There is something fascinating driving this machine remotely with all its discrete indicators instead of a display screen as in modern generators. As you can see in this test, I actually cycled through all the waveforms for each step. Here's the result for sine waves. The other waveforms look very similar. I used the logarithmic x-axis, otherwise the millivolts would all be bunched up on the left. The red and yellow bars are the tolerance values from the spec. As you can see, the generator meets its specification, but to be honest, plus minus 2% as the tightest tolerance is pretty generous. I used the same setup with a small change of the script to test sine flatness over the important audio range of 10 to 200 kHz. There is no point of going higher because I reach the limit of my multimeters. Even within that range, you see that they start to noticeably divert at the very low and very high frequencies. I use the amplitude calibration point of 1 kHz, the 0 dB reference, and within the range, the flatness generally meets the 0.5% tolerance. Finally, offset. To adjust this, one has to use the sine waveform at 1.6 volts peak to peak, or about 0.57 volts RMS, and apply a plus 5 volt offset. I decided to set up the meter to show just the DC part on the main display and AC on the secondary. The plus 5 volt offset is about 65 millivolts too high, and the offset should be adjusted to be within plus minus 50 millivolts. But there's only one trim pot, and it affects both positive and negative offsets, so one needs to keep an eye at both to get both of them in spec. Basically, the idea is to reduce the error and distribute the remaining offset error more or less equal between positive and negative. After a lot of switching and trimming, I decided that minus 10 millivolts for negative offset and plus 17 millivolts for positive is well within spec for both and good enough for me. I just thought it might be interesting to show the two remaining things that the generator can do and another bug I have not shown so far. First, the A201 can be used to measure external frequencies. Here is 10 Hz for my FY6600 generator and you can see what the GPSDO HP counter shows. Going to 100 Hz, to 1 kHz, to 10 kHz, 100 kHz now, 1 MHz, 10 MHz, 20 MHz, and even though this is a 20 MHz machine, it can measure 30 MHz, but not 40. Another thing is that in pulse mode you can decide if you want pulse that cross 0 volts, or just positive, or just negative. Let me demonstrate. At the moment the amplitude is set to 8 volts and the output pulses in yellow are swimming from minus 8 volts to plus 8 volts because no 50 ohm termination is in use. I can tell the generator to just use 0 as the low value so that the output is just positive pulses, which might be handy to drive, say, logic inputs. But I can equally tell it to use 0 as the high value and now we have negative pulses. And back to full size. Up to 10 of these settings, including frequency, amplitude, pulse width and so on, can be stored and recalled. Now for the bug. I should be able to invert the pulse using this button, but as you can see, nothing happens on the output. That's strange, and I suspected another faulty component, but I could have sworn that I had seen this function working earlier. I finally realized that it works as soon as you enter a lead or trail time that is larger than a minimum 10 nanoseconds. That is so little that you won't be able to spot it in the pulse shape on the scope in this setup. It's a software bug because I traced the circuit diagram and the gate that inverts the signal works fine and is controlled by yet another of these 4094 shift registers, pin 11 of U1 on the pulse generator in this case. With a default lead time of 10 nanoseconds, pressing the invert key does nothing on that pin. But as soon as some lead time is entered, the pin changes state as it should when toggling the button and the signal gets inverted. Tony in Dresden, who has the same unit but without the option that enables entering lead or trail times, confirmed that the invert function does not work at all on his machine. Since the inverting gate is on the pulse generator, there is no hardware reason why this function is depending on the presence of an option and why it depends on entering non-defaults. Apart from this bug, it's all working. As part of the repair, I replaced all electrolytic capacitors and a bunch of tantalum caps and replaced 3 dead chips, 2 digital to analog converters and 1 LM311 comparator. Really bad caps were only these 2, the left failing open and the right one failed as short circuit. The electrolytic capacitors were all still usable. This 220 microfarad cap, for example, is still 214 microfarad with an ESR of 0.6 ohm and a dissipation factor of 0.11. Those last 2 parameters are on the high side, but still workable. For comparison, a brand new Panasonic cap I used as replacement is 217 microfarad with an ESR of 0.3 ohm and a dissipation factor of 0.05. Both parameters just half of the 30 plus year old capacitor. I learned a lot while doing the repair, and as far as the number of individual components, this is the largest device I've ever tried to repair. Just look at these numbers. 609 resistors, of which some are actually networks, 256 capacitors, 135 diodes, 176 discrete transistors or FETs, and 135 integrated circuits. Of all these, only 2 capacitors and 3 ICs were defect. For now, everything is working, and the question is of course, was it worth it? If you consider just the cost of the counter itself and the repair material, it was certainly a bargain. since I was doing this repair as a hobbyist, commercial considerations and the many hours spent do not apply, because otherwise this unit would definitely have been on the junk heap as not economically repairable. Except for the beefier final amplifier and the pulse rise fall time capability, my little FY6600 function generator can do all what the A201 or rather the A241 can do. Actually more, because it can also do sweeps, AM and a bunch of other modulations, arbitrary waveforms, including DC. It has two channels which can be set up individually. My model can go up to 50 MHz for sine waves and is overall more accurate. Yet, I love playing with a discrete generator and decided to keep it around at least for a while until I run out of space. If you have not subscribed already, hit that button and the notification bell so you don't miss the next video. And maybe consider becoming a Patreon, link in the description. As Patreon you get early access to videos, a blog and other exclusive content. Thanks for watching.